part of Relationship Junkie, and I want to speak to you in a big way. Today, I'm going to simply call this message Side by Side, Face to Face. Side by Side, Face to Face. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit. I'm going to talk to people building friendships and people, and even in marriage relationships. I'm going to talk to singles. I'm going to talk to everybody here today. And we want you to not be in a relationship junkie that jumps from one relationship to the next. We want you to have some solid, deep relationships. And I want to try to help you with that today. Hey, friendship is one of the most forgotten elements of marriage. They're just good old friends. Just being friends has been forgotten. And most people see marriage as romance spice with a little bit of friendship. But it's really marriage is friendship spiced with romance. One respected sociologist says it this way: the determining factor in whether both wives and husbands feel satisfied with the sex, romance, and passion in a marriage is by, and this is 70% of people said this, both men and women, the quality of the couple's friendship. And so that's men and women said that. So you got to hear that, because maybe we're not from a different planet after all. Men and women both are hungry for friendship and base the quality of their marriage off of that. I want to read a verse from you, or a few verses, and if you haven't picked it out by now, last week I was on this this book, and I'm going to be dealing more with it today, and that's Ephesians chapter 5, verses 25 through 28, and then I'm going to read verse 31. Here we go. You ready? Husbands, all right, talking to all the dudes, husbands, love your wives. Husband, love your wives as, as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Like, dude, you're like, we got a lot to live up to there. That he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word. So he's comparing the marriage relationship with the relationship between Christ and the church. Verse 27, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. He's talking about the church. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. Should love them as your own bodies. But listen to this one. He who loves his wife loves himself. Dude, that's just so good right there. So it's impossible if you really, really love your wife, it's going to reflect on even how much you love yourself. And so let's talk a little bit. Let's look at verse 31 here. Verse 31. In marriage, a man and woman should leave the father and the mother and cleave. And so I put this to kind of explain it to you a little bit, or become one with. Cleave, leave and become one with his wife. So that's really the kind of the essence of marriage, isn't it? And that is becoming one. So when we're talking about marriages, when you marry, you become one. In fact, when Adam saw Eve in the garden, he said, "This is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh." He's saying there, I see a part of who I am in you. I see my own soul. I see my own body in you. It's a little different than us dudes going, "Hey, man, she's a hot babe." You know, it's a little deeper than that. So he said, I see a part of who I am, my own soul, my own body. There's depth right there. C.S. Lewis, who is a famous writer, he's gone, but he's affected you whether you realize it or not. You've watched movies that he wrote. So C.S. Lewis, famous Christian writer, wrote something that I want to share with you, just a couple statements here, but I want to kind of exemplify it here today, or kind of act it out here a little bit. So first service we used Pastor Cody and Melanie. And after service, Melanie said, I really wish you had spread the love so more people would feel the love But I really feel like that Pastor Cody and Melanie really need a great introduction to Parkway. And you really haven't been introduced to Parkway until you've been used in a message, right? Anybody, or would y'all rather me use y'all? Oh, that's what I thought. Okay, Pastor Cody and Melanie, come on up here today. Let's give it up for them right here. So they've got it all figured out now. So listen to what C.S. Lewis said here. And that is this. C.S. Lewis said this. He said, there is one kind of love called Eros. E-R-O-S. Eros. And this is love that is face to face. It's face to face, and they're absorbed in each other. That's the look of absorbed in each other. So I know that y'all probably do this. I just want to be absorbed in you. And so this is that face-to-face connection where that's Eros. Everybody say Eros. And that is that face-to-face love. But then there is another kind of love that the Bible talks about. And C.S. Lewis said this. He said, but there's another kind of love, philia, and we find that in the Bible, which people are side by side. So you have the first kind of love that is face to face, your really deep communication, face to face, and that's deep communication. Y'all scoot over here a little bit. Can y'all do that? And then you have side by side. That's philia. It's side by side that you're absorbed by common interest. Your connection is common interest. I want to help you today. And this is friendship. This is friendship. So that first, the Eros is that deep communication face to face, but then there's side by side and you're connected through a common interest, and this is friendship. Now, this is cool. So we find in love, we find Eros used in the Bible, we find philia and used, you know, y'all know the word philia because we get Philadelphia out of it, what the place of what? Brotherly love, right? That's that place of friendship. We all know as Philadelphia as just being a very friendly place. But anyways, it's supposed to be. Well, anyway, but it's that philia. It's that side by side, okay? So it's in friendship. Now, this is what the enemy wants to do. The Lord wants you to have side by side, face to face. So side by side, in other words, connect through friendship, common interest, and connect face to face and intimacy and conversation. But this is what the enemy wants you to do. This is what he wants you to do. He wants you to live your life like this. He wants you to, maybe you started off side by side, maybe you started off face to face, but he eventually wants you to end up being back to back. Y'all married, get back to back. He wants you to be back to back. So what does that mean? The enemy wants to do that because he wants us to be together but live separately. Maybe in the same house, maybe roommates, but no depth. No depth. And so people have lived together, been married, all this, be married, all this stuff, but somewhere in their relationship, they go back to back. And this is, you'll start hearing things being said like this when you see relationships back to back. You start hearing things like this. We just don't see eye to eye anymore. Well, of course you don't see eye to eye anymore. You're looking in two different directions. They never see my perspective on anything. Well, of course they don't see your perspective. You're looking this way and she's looking this way. And you're seeing two different vantages, and this is called humanism, and this is what the enemy wants to do. He wants you to get so humanistic in your thinking, this is what the world wants to do, that it's all about me, it's all about focused on me, and it's about making myself happy, and in the process, I only see through my eyes, and I never do side by side or face to face, and I'm back to back, and all of a sudden, we start hearing this. People get divorces, and where we hear this, they divorce for unreconcilable differences. In other words, we can't see eye to eye on anything. And because somewhere the enemy has so twisted that relationship to go back to back instead of side to side and face to face. And so I'm preaching today, side by side, face to face. So what I'm saying is, I want you to have both of those in a marriage relationship. We're going to talk about singles too, but in a marriage relationship, I want you to have side by side and face to face. Now, what you can do is don't be guilty of being side by side only. Side by side only. In other words, this would be that we work together on the house together, but that's about as deep as our relationship goes. We have a common interest there. We work on the house together, or we go to all of our kids' sports functions. We do that together. We're centered and focused around that, and that becomes the side by side, which is great, but don't do side by side only. That's wonderful, but don't do that only. Or we can even, let's get spiritual with it. We're serving in the church together. That's beautiful, but if we're only doing that, we're serving together. Well, what happened to them? Well, I really, but that's all the connection they had, is their common interest was serving the church together. And the enemy will throw something at you in this, because he's got you doing that together, but there's no face-to-face. There's no intimacy. So let's do this. Let's look at this. Now, I want you guys to face one another, okay? And let's look at this. Wait. Go back to the side by side. I got some free stuff I want to give you. Everybody say this is free. A lot of people are doing this. I know none of you are doing this. This is all everybody that was at the first service. You people have reached the level of perfection here. But watch this. A lot of folks are doing this. In their side by side, the relationship becomes to them, the center relationship becomes parent, scoot apart, to child. And so the center relationship becomes parent to child instead of husband to wife. And so we live our life, all of our side by side is taking place through Junior. So all of a sudden, Junior grows up and gets out of the picture. And there's no connection in the side-by-side. And all of a sudden we go, well, we hit midlife and we don't have anything in common anymore. Because while Junior was at the house, everything was built around Junior. Now, we love old Junior. Right? We love old Junior. But the most important thing is husband and wife connection in the side-by-side and not parent-child. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 5 says this, or verse 4 says, raise up your child, right? Everybody say raise up. Another word we use right there with raise up your kids is the word rear up your kids. Y'all ever heard that? I'm gonna use this image and have a little bit of fun with it a little bit. Come here, Alec. God bless you, my friend. I can't use Cody for this. So I want you, this is my son, by the way. I know this is not the exact definition of it, but I want you to get a picture of it. Raise up your kids. Rear up your kids. So look, come here. Look. Push your kids. What am I pushing them for? I'm rearing up my kids. Why? I'm pushing them to dependence. Independence. I'm pushing them to independence. But my wife said, baby, you got to get that right. Thank you, Adina. God bless you much. God bless you. Boy, I almost messed it right there. Alec went, oh, yeah. No. Macy paid. Yeah. No, we're rearing. In other words, we're pushing them, we're raising them up to have independence. I don't want them to be dependent on this and us constantly coddling them. Alec's out of here. He said, man, I'm gone. I don't want them, people, can I just say something? I know none of y'all do this, but coddling kids so much to the point that we no longer coddle each other. That's good right there. And so we're coddling the kid. And the kid's 47 years old, and still we're coddling them. So, you know why? Because we're not rearing up, we're not raising up our kids because we've lost the side by side and we've become parent child centered instead of husband and wife centered. And God's saying, I need you to be side by side. I need you to connect again in relation. Is this all right today? And so I'm trying to help you today. And so need you to grow back together in that common interest and grow in that. So I love that image and that rearing up, and hopefully you remember that and kind of use that. The greatest gift, Cody and Melanie, that you can give to your kids, and I know I saw some of them in here today. They would love for me to bring them up too, I'm sure, but I'm not going to. All three here, yeah. No, I'm just not going to. But look, the best thing that Cody and Melanie, y'all come back together, it's killing me. The best thing that you can give those three boys is that you two live strong and you prioritize one another so that those kids can feel the strength in that. In other words, I love Junior, but Junior is not more important than my girl. Junior is not important for me, more important than Adina. I love my kids that are all adults now. I love them, but I got to say, Adina is the one that I'm doing life with. And we're going to do daily life together. She is the most, all the men and women that are married say amen. She's number one. So I'm making that husband, wife, the central thing that went, give it up. Wait, before y'all leave. Face to face. Don't do just face to face only. Face to face is huge. But don't do face to face only. You know what face to face only is? It's intimacy without friendship. Intimacy without friendship. And so let's have side by side. We're together. We're revolving around a common interest. But also, we're doing face-to-face and connection. Now, I'm going to say this. Even in friendships. So let's go outside the marriage deal here. But also in friendships. And this is why we're creating relationship junkies, because we have people that are just so flighty in their relationships. And you can have side by side, you come together of a common interest, even in friendships, and you have face to face. And I don't mean like sexual intimacy, but you have some depth in your conversation. You have depth in your talk. There's something that brings you together. I'm going to talk about that a little bit more in a minute. But something brings you together. And what is the thing that really, really brings together that you have deep, 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 awesome conversation that makes you grow together in friendships? In other words, this is what people say. These two girls, connect on Facebook and, hey, be my friend. And all of a sudden, they're 1 week deep and they go, she my BFF. She's so cute. She's so sweet. She my BFF. She likes crocheting like I do. Y'all ain't know what crocheting is. That's not a good example, but I'm just trying to use something real goofy. But somebody gonna go right now. We're gonna Google crocheting right now. I don't know what it is. But man, she my BFF. And you've known each other a week. And next week we're taking selfies with somebody. She my BFF. Or go hunting with somebody, and we have one little bit of common interest, and all of a sudden they're my BFF. Hey, there's nothing wrong with having BFFs. But I need something to go beyond relationship junkie, where I'm just going through them like a drug, and I don't really stick and build friendships and do life together. Let's give it up for Cody and Melody today. I think they did a wonderful job. Friendship can be found around a lot of things. Common interests, hobbies. Maybe you like one particular sport. So you have a friend and I want you to have deep friendships. I want you guys to have great guy friends that you come together around. Maybe it's around sports, or maybe it's around a hobby. Maybe you enjoy woodworking, whatever, hunting, whatever it may be. but you know, it joins your heart together, and same for ladies, but it may be a favorite band. Now that I sang last week from Chicago and Brian Adams, that's probably your new favorite bands. You're like, I'll never hear them again the same. But we can find friendship around that. But listen to this statement, and I'm going to put this on the screen for you because it's really, really, really deep. Listen to this closely. The deeper the shared interest, the greater the friendship. The deeper the shared interest, the greater the friendship. So it's just surface stuff. You probably got a surface relationship. But as those things start growing deeper, the interests grow deeper and all that stuff. So now this is where I'm going with that. For a Christian, the deepest passion is growing in Jesus and becoming more like Christ. Is that right? That is our deepest passion. That's our number one passion. You're here today because you wanted to grow deeper in Christ. You wanted to go deeper. And let's talk of marriage. Christian marriage is supposed to be the deepest of all marriages because it's, look at this, look, it's two people focused on your greatest passion. That makes sense? So with this statement, you have two Christians coming together. I'm not talking about charlatans. I'm not talking about fakes. But two Christians that their passion is Christ, when they come together, you should have the deepest marriages in the world because you're centered around the deepest and the greatest passions. Tim Keller, who is one of my favorite Christian writers, says this. He says, to fall in love is to look at another person and get a glimpse of the person God is creating and to say, I see who God is making you and it excites me and I want to be a part of that. That's the deepest love. I want to partner with you and God in the journey to get you to the throne of God. We must be saved. Above all, how many everybody say, above all else, I must be saved? Above all, yeah, absolutely. And when we get there, I will look at your magnificence and I will say, this again, Tim Keller's writing, I always knew you could be like this. I got glimpses of it on the earth, but now look at you. Look at you shine. That's our goal. Adina and I's life together, hey, we came together, we had three wonderful children. We're doing our best. We're all this stuff. We're working in the ministry, doing our best and all that. But our ultimate goal for Adina and I is to go to heaven together. Is that all right? It's our ultimate goal. And when our centered around our passion for Christ, it can't help but make us stronger in our side by side and ultimately our face to face. And so I want Dean and I to hear this together one day. And I want my family with us there too. But I want us to hear, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Do you feel that way? It's my number one passion. I want to be saved. And over the years, you lifted each other up. You served one another. You confronted one another. You prayed with one another. You loved each other. And you continually pushed each other towards Christ because it's your goal. You're there together to see each other make it. And so in friendships, marriage is that way, but also in friendships, I want to put people around me that want to see me make it to heaven. If you're pulling on me the wrong way, adios amigos. I'm not into that. I don't want to go that way. In other words, you're jeopardizing the thing that's most precious to me and being my friend to want to pull me away. You're not really being my friend. In fact, you're trying to pull me in to the direction that you're going instead of pushing me towards and leading me to Christ. Folks, I got to be saved. I've got to be saved. And so around me in my life, if you're pulling me in the wrong way, I'm going to tell you something right now. I love you and I believe in you and God bless you. But if you're pulling me away from God, something's got to go, because I got to tell you, my number one passion is to be saved. And if you're really my friend, we're going to go deep in relationship in that, because our common interest is to see each other saved. Is that all right? And so I want you to learn to be really constant in your relationship. Not just fleeting, not junkies, not running from one to the next, but be really, really constant. A friend is someone you know will never leave you. Never leave you, because they're as committed to you as they are to themselves. Go back to the scriptures. They're committed to you as they are to themselves. It's almost like you're like a part of their body. It's that oneness. It's that oneness in relationship. They're there. They're with you. They're constant. I'm going to be there for you. I'm with you in the goods, in the bads, ups and downs of life. I'm with you. Can I get a witness if you want that kind of relationship? Proverbs 17:17 says this: a friend loveth at all time, and a brother is born for adversity. There is constance there. There's a love. They should know, you may get upset with them, but I'm still going to be there. You're not going anywhere. You're the one who believes the absolutely best about them. Even when they make mistakes, you believe that their character, their integrity, that you really believe and believe the best in them. Dan and I call out things from one another. And we believe each other. Sometimes I just got to be honest with you. Now, I know you're not like it, but I get a stinky attitude. Y'all ever get that? And y'all going, oh, my God, I'm about to find a new pastor. I'm sorry. But I get a stinky attitude in life. And in those, I can say something sometimes that I shouldn't have said in my relationship with Adina. I can say things I shouldn't. I can be grouchy. I can do things. But Adina, she told me this a few years ago, and I was so glad because it really gave me some peace. But she said, I know you didn't mean that, because I know your character. I know you love me, and that doesn't give me license to be a jerk. I don't mean that. But that's what friends are. We believe the actual best of one another. We're going to all have down days, and we're all going to have up days. But we know and believe in each other's character. And I want to put that in our marriages. I want to put that in our friendships, that there's going to be days where we're going to disagree. We're going to struggle. There's going to be attitudes. But I'm not so flippant that I just run from one to the next. But we stay in the battle, and we're constant. It kills me, absolutely kills me, to hear spouses tearing their spouses down in public. Or even in private, it just tears me up. It breaks my heart, and I have this sometimes. People come and just wearing out their spouse. I'm like, dude, because what's going to happen here, and this is what I know, is there is no way their spouse will ever open up to them and be open faced because they don't feel safe. And so when they go face to face, there's always going to be resistance. Because there's something blocking that. Because when you get out from that space, you start tearing them down from what you learned in the face-to-face. And so they're not going to trust you in that process. But we are one, man. We are one. There's unity. We're in the marriages, man, we're bone to bone, flesh to flesh. We're one. There's connection. There's oneness there. Does that make sense? And in that, I want to use this example. My body knows that it's safe with me. My body knows it's safe with me. My body knows. I may be unhappy with some parts of my body, but my body knows it can trust me. It can trust me. Now, let me give you an example on that. Trimming each other's fingernails. Now, I know you ladies go all down. Me? I'm going to just tell you. If someone's trimming my fingernails, I can't even remember the last time that would happen. But I'm like, oh, Jesus, right now, Lord, be a help to me. Because I'm like, it's possible they could take off the end of my finger. I don't know. But watch this. When I'm cutting my fingernails, I never go, ah! Because I trust myself. I trust myself that I'm not going. No, I trust myself. You know why? Because Nathan is connected to that. And I don't want to hurt myself. I don't want to bring pain to myself. And when I hurt myself, I'm going to feel that pain. And Nathan is not going to let that happen because Nathan loves Nathan. And even when Nathan does cause the body pain, it's for the body's good. Nathan's presence with his body is constant. I can't get away from that. And your friend, your spouse, needs to be like your body in the sense of there's constant there. Why would I hurt you when we're one? See, when you're back to back, you're not feeling that oneness. But when you're side to side, face to face, you're feeling that oneness. And you're going, hey, there's trust. I always say this, that let there be tons of doors of trust in your house. That open, one opens to another and continues to make the house be full of open doors because there's so much trust in the house. But let that be. Let's move from that and talk about transparency a little bit in marriage. Transparency in marriage. And even transparency in friendship. In order to have a friendship, you've got to open yourself up. And you've got to share what's going on emotionally. Dudes. Men. We stink at this. It's bad. Now, ladies, it's just like born in them. They're like, hey, you want to go drink coffee? And they're like, first they just met, and they're sitting down, they're like, hey, and they sit down, and they look at each other, and they're drinking coffee, and they're just, they're like, I'm like, dude, how y'all do all this stuff? Deep conversation. Women, y'all are like amazing. Dudes, we go play golf together and we're together 4 hours. And your wife will come to you and go, hey, babe, did you know that he just broke up with his girlfriend? Yeah, I did. Did you ask him if he's got someone else? No, I didn't. Well, y'all were together today. Yeah, we're together. Y'all were together like 4 hours. Yeah, I was together 4 hours. You never asked him? That y'all were like that he just broke up? Did you never talk to him about that? Uh-uh. What? And you're like, how would I possibly ask him about that? Like, hey man, that's a great putt. Are you dating anybody? And we're like 4 hours together and we never have that conversation because dudes don't do the emotional talk very often. And that's kind of comes in our nature. However, your friendships or your spouse is craving that in the relationship because we do side by side real good, guys, but we don't do face to face real well. We don't communicate at that next deep level. And so sometimes we'll rally around the side by side and not rally around the face by face. And so, dudes, I'm going to help you. You're either going to love me or hate me for this, probably hate me for this. But I need all the dudes to stand, all the men in the house. I need you to stand. And right now you're going, do I want to be man right now? I don't know if I want to be a man. Just go ahead and own it. Stand up. Are y'all ready, guys? They're like, I'm not sure. Not sure. I'm going to be a blessing to you. I'm going to be a blessing. I'd love you. I'm with you on this, okay? I'm going to give you a pastoral challenge, all right? Pastoral challenge. Say, I'm ready to take it. All right, take it like a man, all right? I'm ready to take it. you're going to have to take this one like a man. You're going to, okay, here we go. You ready? You ready? Here we go. This is a pastoral challenge. This week, for 1 week, I mean, it's going to push you. It's going to push you. Ready? Here we go. This is what I want you to do. I want you to lean into this emotional side just a little bit. You're like, oh, God, here we go. All right, while you're right, I want you to tell your wife one thing that happened that day and how you felt about it. You're like, and your wife is like, oh, I got to see this happen. This is going to be good. Look here. Tell your wife one thing that happened that day. See, even when we read that, we're like, sounds a little, I did like that guy, but I don't know about that preacher. He did not hear from God today. Now stay standing just a second, guys. You come home from work. Let me tell you what this looks like. You come home from work, and for like 5 or 10 minutes, I mean, just like, you're like, thought it was going to be a couple hours there. Okay, just sit down or step up to her, walk up to her, and just say, hey, baby, I want to tell you something that happened today. And I'm going to just tell you, it don't have to be bad. Let me tell you something happened today at work. And it made me feel. Once your wife passes completely out, revives herself again, and stands back up, she's going to be like, yes, Parkway Life Church is my home church. Okay? Because your wife is craving. I'm not saying bad. I'm not talking about God. And let me just give one more buffer on this. Ladies, go easy on him here, okay? It's this new deal. Don't make this a 2-hour conversation. And you don't have to respond here with all of your feelings. We're already getting that a lot. I'm just saying, let your dude talk a bit. Let him just share it. Don't bring up all of his issues and struggles. And I'm helping you guys, see, coming back in your good graces. But just make connection. Just walk in the house and just say, hey, babe, I want to tell you something happened today. I mean, you don't have to hold her hand and get all weird. Just, hey, let me tell you something happened today. And, man, this really happened. This made me feel this way. And you're connecting. You don't even realize it, but you're connecting on a face-to-face level that's deeper than you're used to. And that's why it's pushing against your grain, because it's connecting in a different way. And what's going to happen is after this, something that you gets up in your spirit and realize, hey, this works out good for me. This works out good for me that when I connect with this level, it also could be possible. It just makes things go deeper in the relationship. And you need depth, because the enemy wants to steal the depth and turn you back to back. And you've been married 30 years and you don't even know each other. Is this an okay word today? I hope. Now, I want you to raise your right arm, guys. Raise your right arm. I'm watching. I'm looking. Justin, it took you a while to get yours up. Take it. All right. And when you watch. All right. Okay. And say, Pastor, I accept the challenge. That was pitiful. It was really embarrassing. You did not want her to hear it, and she's sitting right next to you. Here we go. Pastor, I accept the challenge. Oh, guys, I'm proud of you. Ladies, give it up for your dudes right there, right? Huh? Hey, you single guys? It's, you know, you're dating somebody, throw that at them. Hey, let me tell you something happened to me today. I'm telling you, you're going to get some brownie points. All right, here we go. So that transparency is happening in that relationship. Transparency and friendship is allowing your friend to call out your sin. Call out your inconsistencies. If you don't have anybody in your life that's close enough to you to call out your sin, you don't have any real friends. If everybody just goes, oh, God bless you, wonderful, that's great, you just could be a sinner. You don't have anybody that's real deep friends in your life. You don't have anybody that calls you out on your inconsistencies. I'm a pastor, obviously you know that. But one of the things that I do, one part of being a pastor, it's probably the smallest part, but one of the parts of being a pastor is standing in front of communicating to you every week. And I love that. That's part. That's for me, it's a part I love. But I communicate. I speak. I mean, even right here today, I've said so many words, and I'm saying them so fast. So my mind is going, okay? In that, I'm going to say things that I shouldn't be saying. And instead, I'm going to make mistakes. I'm going to have grammatical errors. I'm going to say things. And I have to fix it in my daily conversation to fix it up here because my brain's going too fast to fix all of my grammatical errors and things that I shouldn't be saying like that. So I have to fix it in my daily conversation. Well, guess who's with me daily? So she calls out some of that stuff for me. That's a friend. She calls out and says, hey, you shouldn't say this that way, or you're using the wrong pronunciation or that, or you're saying this. That's my buddy, man. But the first thing I want to do is go, come on, baby, I'm telling the truth. I do good on this about 80% of the time. Don't change that. 80% of the time, I set that percentage. Because there's sometimes I want to go just, let me be. But she's calling that out of me because she wants me to be the best that I can be. Why? Because she really loves me. So she's calling out an inconsistency. She's calling out something, and I have to be humble to receive this, and our natural tendency is to reject counsel. Is that the truth? We reject counsel. We struggle with it. I said something a few weeks ago, or a few months ago, that really embarrassed me in a first service. And Alec came up to me after that and said, Dad, you can't say that again. That means this to kids now. And I'm like, oh, you're crazy. Anyway, you know what I did? I fixed it. But I realized, Nathan Keating, shut up, because you're getting counsel and it's speaking to you, and you need to listen. And so I shook myself, and even after service, I said, Alec, thank you for saying that and speaking that to me, because I needed that spoken to me, because I didn't need to say that again, because I didn't know it meant that. And so, and y'all don't need to know what that is, because it was not good. So it really was. It was really bad. And it's been a long time now, so y'all are not even going to find that in the unless those knuckleheads bring it back up. You keep your mouth shut right now, boy. So why, Alec, don't you take any payment from anybody to get that, Jake Pippen? So are you understanding what I'm saying, though? And I want you to connect it in that way. So our natural tendency is to reject counsel. I want you to look at this verse. It's so good. It's Proverbs chapter 9, verse 8. It says this: reprove a wise man. Reprove a wise man, and he will love you. Man, this is so good. But fools despise wisdom and correction. Is that, what about that right there? Reprove a wise man, and he will love you for it. But fools despise wisdom and correction. So let me ask you this real quick. It's a tough question. Are you a fool, or are you wise? Listen to this. Your natural tendency is to be a fool. If you just go with what's on your, just go with what's natural, you'll be a fool. Reason I know this is because it says reprove a wise man. You have to be intentional for wisdom. So the natural thing to come out with when you're reproved, when you're corrected, when you're shown your fallacies, when you're shown your sin, the first thing you want to do is be angry at that. That's your natural tendency to be a fool. But if you're wise, you receive that, and he will love you. He will love you. Man, I think that's so good. So in all relationships, and especially married, we tend to assume the positives and notice the weaknesses. But I want you to change that out a little bit, around a little bit, and I want you to speak blessing and empowerment over their lives. I don't want you to just focus on all their weaknesses, but I want you to start bringing out power. I like to say it this way. Bring out the king in him. Bring out the king in him. Speak life into him. Call out what you see in him as amazing. How long has it been, ladies, since you looked at your man and you called out what you see is amazing in him? Well, we've been married 40 years now. He already knows. Tell him. Call that out of him. Call out the king in him. And when you start bragging on that, if you're dating somebody, call that out of them. See the good in them and call that out. There will be time that you notice the weakness, but right now, bring that out. Empower them. Call the king in them. Hey, guys, look at your lady and call out the queen in her. Speak life over here. I love it when you wear this. I love it when you do your hair like this. I love it when you say that. I love your smarts here. I love your wisdom here. Call that out. Don't speak down to you, idiot. You bump, bump. I mean, all these different, you knucklehead. You're a dummy. You're uneducated. Don't beat your husband or your wife up like, call out something and call. I like to say it like this. Put the crown of Jesus over them and help them grow into it. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise about that. Help them grow into it. So call out the king, call out the queen. And this works in friendships or marriage. Now, I'm going to speak to the singles. I'm going to close this message out today. In the next 10 minutes, I'm going to close this message out speaking to singles. So if you're a single in the house, listen up. Going to be a little tough, but the married people are tired of getting beat up. All right, here we go. You ready? Single people, I need to talk to you just a second, okay? Single people. I'm going to talk to you some things about building friendships. It's really, really huge. It's going to help set you up for marriage too. So here we go. You ready? Number one. Prioritize friendships in the dating process. Prioritize friendships in the dating process. It's kind of stereotyped that men overvalue looks in a mate and women overvalue earning potential. And this is the deal. Beauty kind of fades. To be honest with you, we all kind of start looking the same. You know, we all kind of start looking the same. We all kind of start looking the same. And the earning potential, it may not always be there, or maybe so. But an endearing friendship during marriage, singles, listen to this, is not going to be built around those two things. And so in counsel, my wife, very rarely when she's counseling people, does she have a lady look at her and say, my husband is just, he don't look good looking anymore. It's never about a husband's looks. You know what it's always about? His character. He's got some character issues. Got some character. That's what she's hearing all the time. But isn't it funny that in our dating process, we don't look at the one thing that really is going to matter? And so we're looking for all this in dating. I'm sorry. We're looking for all this during dating. And we're not even looking, ladies. We're not even looking at character. And so later on, it starts affecting us. Number two, next practical word for singles. I'm sorry about this. It's going to hit hard. It's going to be, I don't care if you think it's old-fashioned or whatever. It's Bible and it's big stuff. Don't marry a non-Christian. Oh, well, I'll win them and I'll do all this stuff once we get married. See how that works out. Good for you. And this is why. First of all, because the Bible says it. But second of all, you cannot share deepest unity together. Because you have a heart for God, and if you marry somebody that doesn't have a heart for God, the thing that's deepest is it's your passion for Christ, and you won't share that together. And so there's a level of intimacy that's not there that you don't share together. Now, I'm not trying to be harsh or mean and all that. I'm trying to help you here. You say, well, Pastor, I'm married. to a non-Christian now? What do I do now? I'm married a non-Christian. Should I go home and leave them? No! No! God, and through the power of His God's grace, can help you find purpose as a Christian married to a non-Christian. If you've already done that, step into that and have purpose to let God use you to start calling out the king or the queen and whoever you married, and let God do the work. And I'm going to say this, God's grace can do amazing things. And I'll tell you something else too. If you're married to an unbeliever, what a church to bring them to help them find the grace of God. Can I get a witness? So don't leave out of here with your head dragging, say, I already made a mistake in this. Know that the grace of God can have purpose in that situation, even in a situation where you chose maybe to go outside and not do things the way God can help you. God can help you. If I don't believe that, I need to go sell shoes somewhere. I really believe God can help you, and let the grace of God do its work in the process. Amen? But date. You're going to marry the kind of people you're dating, so you need to be dating people that are Christians. And I will tell you this, surprise, there's charlatans in the church. A charlatan is a fake. So you can marry somebody that's calling themselves a Christian, and they're a knucklehead. They're a wolf in sheep's clothing. That's why you date and you don't do the next thing that I'm going to tell you. Number three, beware the intoxication of physical contact. Beware. Physical erotic contact has a way of clouding all of your judgment, and you can't even think right. You will do things, say things. Oh, you'll go right, and you know all the wrong. Their character is jacked. But because you are physically in an erotic situation with them, face-to-face, deep stuff, all of a sudden, it's clouded your mind, and you're thinking about choosing a partner that you would never choose if that wasn't on the table, because you would pick up there's major character issues, and there would be an alarm, because God's got your conscience in you that would send up an alarm that says, they're crazy. But you can't hear, they're crazy, because y'all get it? And so you need to be looking, is this a lifelong friend? Do we share the ultimate death together in our passion for Christ? And so if we're caught up in the infatuation and the buzz of sex, I can't think through that clearly. And so God's way really is the way that works. And so let me tell you why there's so many marriages that are so bad. And this is tough to hear, but people have gotten through the infatuation stage of marriage, and now they're bored. It's tough to hear. Sorry to say this, but this is something Adina and I are seeing tons. We're seeing ladies that give away sex freely in dating, get married, and shut down. And the dude is going, bro, it wasn't like this when we were dating. It was free. They used the most precious thing they had to bring you in, but there was never any side-by-side to build friendship. And God's way was for you to have deep side-by-side over common interests, and even face-to-face, not sex, but face-to-face depth. And then when you come into marriage, marriage becomes the icing on the cake. Marriage becomes the most beautiful, sex becomes the most beautiful thing in marriage when it's approached the right way. Now, again, I'm going to speak a little grace of God here. You're saying, Pastor, I did everything wrong. When we dated and we're married, I did everything wrong. Pastor, right now, I'm dating and I'm doing everything wrong. That's the beauty of church. That's the beauty of the blood of Christ. It's the beauty of the grace of God. It's a place for you to come in and go, oh, that's why this is how it's, why it's happening like this. That's what's going on. And all of a sudden, it's called repenting. You repent, you turn around, and you start doing things a different way. And all of a sudden, God helps you and clears your mind, and things become clear to you, and you get a God-based marriage that has tons of depth in it. Amen? Amen, amen, amen. Amen. You're like, oh my goodness. This is throwing a lot at us. So let me close like this. So sex outside of a lifelong covenant is separating the soul from the body and having unity in one area but not the other. Your body's trying to have oneness, but your soul doesn't. And there's always conflict. Unity of the body without unity of the soul. I don't have time to preach this, but there was a whole chapter, whole book of the Bible that really focused on one particular church, and this is what they had in the Bible. They were separating the body and the soul and said they were different. And there's a spirit to it. And Paul worked it over in the Word of God that you're separating body and soul, and you can do anything with your body as long as you have soul. And that becomes really fake in Christianity. It becomes fake in friendships. And so God wants you to have the unity of the body and of the soul. And in that relationship, you're going to have the deepest relationship you can possibly imagine. Thank you for letting me speak to you today. I know we're on yard going, let's go back to fresh wind, fresh fire. We want to feel the power of the Holy Ghost. You know what that was? Fresh wind, fresh fire? Power? Fresh wind, fresh fire. You know what that was? Face to face. Now we're talking side by side. And God wants Filio and Eros to be together. And so that's, I think, the church should have some face to face, but it also has to have the side to side. We've got to connect. We've got to be better. We've got to be friends. If you're in a life group right now, don't just go to the life group with your book and sit down and try to get out as soon as you can. Connect with somebody. If you're going through freedom right now, you're going through the most life-changing process that you've gone to date in the church probably. Get in that. You're connecting through the power. Let there be beauty. Let there be friendships built in that. That's just beautiful. I want to do something today to close. We're not going to close this with a big song and music, and we may need to, but we're not, okay? I want Adina to come up here just a minute, and I want her to pray over you. Adina has devoted her education and her life to studying and helping marriages and helping friendships and relationships, and she's a licensed marriage and family therapist. I want her to step up here, and I don't want to be all therapy today. I want her to pray in the Spirit of the Lord. Would you stand with me? And I want her to pray over your friendships. I want her to pray over your marriage. I want to pray over your life. And I want your life to be blessed. I'm going to tell you, as a pastor, Dina and I have a passion for you to have strong relationships, strong friendships. I want to be so much that, say you hit a rocky time in this church, because the devil's sly, right? You hit a rocky time in this church, but your friendships are so deep that you stay connected. Isn't that cool? All right. I want Dina to pray over you today.
God, I thank you so much for the word that's gone forth today. And Lord, I just ask in the weeks to come that, Lord, you will deepen our relationship with you first of all, God, that our relationship with you would grow deeper. Because if our relationship with you grows deeper, then it will overflow into our marriage, into our friendships. God, help us to walk side by side in our marriages, but not only side by side, but face to face. You created all of this, God, not just one part, but all of it. So, God, I pray you would bless our marriages for face to face and side by side, for the relationships to grow deeper. Pray for our friendships, God, that they would grow deeper as we begin to communicate and to share and to grow deeper together, God. I just pray you would bless each and every one here, every single, every married person, God, just bless our relationships and let them be centered around you and let it bring glory to you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Everybody say side by side. Face to face. Are you glad you came to church today? Woo, God bless you. Turn around to somebody in the area and give them a big old high five if they're your friend. If not, just act like they are. Hey, God bless you. We'll see you next week. Have a great, great week.